You may well be forgiven for thinking that rockets, which take off vertically and then land again vertically, were a recent development by the likes of Blue Origin and SpaceX. But a quick look back into the history of rocketry and you'll see that this technique is far from new and was first used nearly 60 years ago. Curious Droid. Just to get a rocket to take off and land vertically requires a lot of technology to come together. You need to have enough thrust to take off, but then enough fuel left to descend back to Earth. You also need to be able to relight the engines at up to hypersonic speeds as the rocket falls back to the ground. You need to be able to gimbal or tilt the engines and the rocket's angle of descent without it tumbling out of control. You also need to be able to throttle down the engines to a small amount of thrust comparable to that which is required to launch the rocket with the same engines, and you need legs to land on and the mechanism with which to deploy them. The image of rockets landing vertically on their tail fins has been popularized in science fiction since the early 1930s, though it took nearly 30 years to bring the technology to a point where it could be used practically, though it wasn't quite in the way you might have expected. The first instance of a rocket-powered vertical takeoff and vertical landing was shown in 1961 with the Bell rocket belt. Although the first rocket pack had been developed and patented by a Russian, Alexander Andreev, in 1919, and various people since have claimed to have invented things like the flying rucksack, it wasn't until the mid-1950s that Bell Aerosystems started work on the Bell rocket belt for the US Army. The rocket belt used a hydrogen peroxide engine, but the 19 litres of fuel in the tanks could only provide 21 seconds of flight and travel around about 120 metres. But it was a hit with the public, and it was toured around the world and also appeared in the 1965 James Bond film Thunderball. But the US Army were less impressed with the amount of backup required to get one man 120 metres, and they cancelled the contract. But within a few years, there would be a rocket-powered vertical takeoff and vertical landing vehicle that would be a total success and be seen by hundreds of millions of people around the world. That vehicle was the Apollo Lunar Lander, a design that was used in the most inhospitable place man had ever been to and worked without fail on 6 separate missions. Though when you think about it, it actually worked in reverse, because it dropped from orbit to land on the moon, and then the ascent module, which was only part of the lunar lander, took off to return the crew back to the command module and then back onto Earth. There was also an advantage to landing on the moon because it only has 1/6 the gravity of that on the Earth. Fighting gravity is the biggest issue for any rocket, but particularly one which had to slow and hover to find a landing spot. Although the lander had some automation in the form of radar to detect the distance from the ground and computer control of a single engine, when the radar, which should have been turned off for the final part of the descent, was accidentally left on, it overloaded the computer with data. Without the computer, it fell to Neil Armstrong to manually land the lander on the surface of the moon. Armstrong was well versed with the procedure, and he had trained on the Earth-based version of the lander, which was affectionately known as the flying bedstead. In Earth's gravity and with no computers to help him, he describes controlling it as like trying to balance a plate on the end of a broom handle. And on one occasion, when a thruster ran out of fuel, he had just a second's notice to eject and avoid almost certain death as the vehicle lost control and crashed. This shows just how difficult it is to actually land something which is powered by rockets, especially an object which is tall and thin and not really designed to come back in the reverse manner of how it took off. It wasn't until the mid-1990s that the first true vertical takeoff and vertical landing rocket was seen in the form of a Mcdonnell Douglas Delta Clipper Experimental, the DC-X. The idea of a low-cost, single-stage-to-orbit vehicle using off-the-shelf components was proposed to Mcdonnell Douglas in 1985 by Max Hunter, their ex-chief engineer for space systems, who had been thinking of a concept since the 60s, but Mcdonnell Douglas weren't interested in funding the idea themselves. So Hunter, who had also worked for President Ronald Reagan's Strategic Defense Initiative Organization, or SDIO, went with Jerry Purnell and General Graham to sell the idea to Vice President Dan Quayle on the premise that any space-based defense system would need a delivery system that would be far cheaper, more reliable, and with much faster turnaround times than the space shuttle. With the approval of a project and it coming under the SDIO banner, away from the bureaucracy of NASA and the Air Force, it allowed the small team of around 100 people at Mcdonnell Douglas to build a 1/3 scale prototype in just 21 months for a cost of just $60 million starting in 1991. The design would take off like a normal rocket and then land back again in the same vertical position as it took off on extendable legs, under its own power and without any parachutes. The prototype was never designed to go into orbit, and in fact it only ever flew to a height of around 2.5 kilometers, but that was enough to prove the concept. The outer shell was custom built by Scale Composites, and the rest of the craft, including the RL-10A engines and the control systems, were off-the-shelf components. The testing program started in 1993 and flew 3 test flights until funding ran out as a result of the SDI program coming to an end. NASA provided further funding and testing resumed. On one flight, a minor explosion occurred and the DC-X can be seen with a hole in its side, but it successfully performed an abort and an auto landing. After the repairs, it continued testing in 1995. But after a hard landing cracked the outer shell, and again funding had been cut, there was not enough funds to carry out repairs. During 1995, NASA begrudgingly agreed to take on the project because of its previous test flight successes, but with several upgrades, and the project would be renamed as the DC-XA. In 1996, testing resumed, but this time it was also in competition with the Lockheed Martin X-33 Venture Star project, which NASA had chosen as a possible replacement for the shuttle. And ultimately, the DC-X lost out to what NASA said were budgetary constraints. But to many, the X-33 was NASA's pet project, and the DC-X was something they didn't really want, even though the cost of building a new DC-XA was just $50 million, a very cheap price when compared to other rocket projects. NASA would go on to spend $920 million on the X-33 over the next few years, only to cancel it at the last minute due to technical issues with the composite fuel tanks and before any test flights had taken place. Although the DC-X was at an end, it inspired the Blue Origin New Shepard, and some of the engineers which worked on the DC-X project went on to work at Blue Origin. Although SpaceX won't say directly, we can see the influence of the DC-X on the Falcon 9 reusable rockets too. Some NASA engineers also believe the DC-X concept would make a good Mars lander with a crew of up to 6 people. The testing on Earth proved that it could be done, and with the weaker gravity of Mars, the payload capacity would be greatly enhanced. And so we come to the present day, with both SpaceX and Blue Origin both using similar techniques to the DC-X, though with the benefit of the extra time since the demise of the DC-X, the designs have moved on considerably, with the SpaceX Falcon 9 proving that it can be used for delivering commercial and military payloads into orbit, and even sending a car to Mars. They say that there is nothing new and that we stand on the shoulders of giants, and that's pretty much true. But each step of the way needs skilled people to fully understand what has gone before in order to build the new ideas. Just as the DC-X proved the principle of vertical takeoff, in-air maneuvering and vertical landing, SpaceX have taken those principles and found new solutions to enable them to make a fully working reusable rocket delivery system. And that takes people that have the skills to make those next steps. Our sponsor for this video, Brilliant.org, is dedicated to helping you gain those skills, turning you into a living, breathing, and most importantly, calculating scientist. Head over there and prove for yourself what it takes to get a rocket into orbit. Having a strong math and science skill set is crucial because it opens so many ways to explore the universe. To support Curious Droid and learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/Curious Droid and sign up for free. So if you're ready to launch off the planet, then the first 200 people will get a 20% discount off of the annual premium subscription.